Hey all, I'm going to demonstrate how you can test my E145 policy model, which is a policy model that I created, which is on GitHub. I'm basically going to show you how you can basically test it out. I'll do it the manual way. I won't be using my scripts and stuff like that. So let's just open this one to see which disk it's using. I'm going to have to install a new virtual machine, obviously. I'm going to do it from the ground up. So yeah, you'll be advised to do it in a virtual machine because even though I have this stuff SDK1, even though I have this stuff on bare metal on my laptop, SDK1. So create a new network install, and then Fedora 20 is it, I suppose. We're going to just install Fedora 20 and then no base text install. You'll be advised to do that because that's what I'm currently only really support, although it might actually work in graphical user interface. But so Fedora 20 is our base install in with basically a minimal install. Well, let's just use 248 and 2 threads. Dev SDK 1, dev SDK 1. This just looks new. Yeah, this looks new. Let's just do network 3. Let's see if this works. I'm basically used to using my script. I have a shell script that basically does it with kickstart files and stuff like that, so I'm not really comfortable with doing it manually. So, installing a Fedora 20 system manually. So E45 policy, it's actually, I started with designing it on a virtual machine, then later on I bought a E145 laptop, which is a very Lenovo laptop, a very, is it actually downloading anything? Very slow laptop with AMD CPU, and so I thought to myself, okay, what, that was just a toy, what do I want to do with that? So I decided, okay, let's just install Rawhide in there, so I have at least a Rawhide system, and just use a minimal install so basically it's just a minimal install on a laptop. And let me just do this, Amsterdam, to installing source, 3, minimal, continue. Installation destination for sucks this manual stuff. One, I suppose. One. Replace existing Linux. Continue. LVM. Continue. What else do we have? Installation destination. User creation. So let's create a user. C7. Username. One. Create a user, use password. And six. Wow. I didn't think it was. Wait. It used to be. Use password four. Five. Password ABC123. ABC123. You have provided a weak password. Yes. Oh, yes. That looks fine. Username. Joe. Continue. Root password is not set. ABC123. ABC123. So you have provided, yes. Okay, now this looks like I'm set. Continue. So where was I? So yeah, this EVE145 laptop, it's a neat little toy. I have it installed, a minimal rawhide installed. So yeah, rawhide is cool as long as you don't have a lot of it. So a minimal rawhide install, not much can go wrong. The kernel is usually pretty usable, and the core components are pretty usable, but if you start installing all the graphical shit, then things start to break really bad real soon. So basically I have this rawhide installed on my laptop, and I have some nice console apps like MUD, Mercy, a whole bunch of them, and you can see it in the policy, the ones that I use. Some I don't have confined because some of them are interpreted scripts, and I don't like confining interpreted scripts because you can basically get in those scripts two ways, by the first by the interpreter and the other way by just running the script directly. So that's just too many scenarios for my mind to deal with. But anyway, so the policy that I created is optimized for rawhide. It won't work on Fedora 20 because for example, the init control FIFO file is in Fedora 20 is still in /dev. The devlog SOC file is still in dev, and in my policy, that all moved to run systemd. So yeah, if you test this on a plain Fedora system, then that's not going to happen. Or you'll see a lot of ABC denials that I'm not seeing. So then you won't have a good view of the current state. So yeah, that's why I'm actually telling you to, if you want to test it, use rawhide, because the policy is designed or is created on a rawhide system. So and even then, there's some stuff that I don't use that is installed by default. For example, firewall d I don't like firewall d it's a Python app, and I don't like it. I like the old IP table services, basically. So that's one of the things. I removed cron because on my small system, my text-based system, I don't need cron. There's only one script that is run, which is basically updating the manual pages, stuff like that. So I'm not going to run the cron service and the Anacron service just for that. I use systemd timer units if I want to basically make something execute at a particular time. So yeah, I basically have that in systemd, so why will I add a long-running service to the lists of my worries if I can just do it with systemd? And there's a couple of other things. So yeah, and SSHD, I don't have SSHD on my laptop, so there's no SSHD policy yet installed, although there is a policy for SSH client. Although it's really simple to create an SSHD policy now, because everything, the underlying infrastructure is there. It's just basically labeling the executable file and stuff like that. Return to quit. And then basically write your policy. It's pretty easy to do. All right, so let's boot this stuff up and then just go to Rawhide immediately. Or first update the system, then go to Rawhide. We don't want to get into any weird situation. So this takes a little while, unfortunately, but it gives me an opportunity to talk a little bit about my system. So I'll just log in as root, abc123, and just run yum update. Update. But like I said, I'm using the policy day to day. I'm not saying that it's flawless, because I basically have a particular use pattern, and as soon as you stray from the that pattern, you'll probably hit ABC denials. But for my use case, it just works reasonably currently. Now, hopefully, this will work as well. This demo, that would be, or at least to some extent, that would be nice. But the policy is pretty heavily tested. I basically use it for a couple of weeks now and fixed bugs everywhere. So the policy has a particular model. Basically, the idea is to confine as much of the system space as possible. And there are some things to know about that. For example, I have this systemd daemon type that is for daemons that are currently not covered by the policy. So if you, for example, have a daemon that is not covered by the policy, then that daemon will automatically run in the system daemon type, with the system daemon type, and that domain is unconfined. So it ships with an unconfined module. If you remove that module, then the systemd daemon type will be there, but it will no longer work, because there's no actual rules associated other than the unconfined rules. So if you remove unconfined, then you are really required to actually deal with those kind of issues. And the only user domain session is also unconfined. But I have also transitions to confined domains. So it's basically the best of two worlds. From if you run in the systemd domain, then most of it runs unconfined, except a couple of programs that are target. So it's really a targeted policy. It's really a targeted policy. But yeah, if you know a little bit of SELinux, and the SEL policy language really makes it nice, so you can really tune it really easy. And that'll also show you, because currently with SELinux you have all these fancy tools and that you use to add mappings and stuff like that, and that makes stuff just really that much harder, because you have to learn all those commands as well. And with my SEL policy, it's basically text files, and that's basically all it is. It's text files and a compiler. Oh yeah, and I need to actually also we need to actually also install the compiler. And I probably should demo that as well. So yeah, that's just something I want to demo this from scratch. But anyways, so you have this compiler, this policy compiler, and the text files, and basically you'll see that I just clone the Git repository inside etcsc Linux, and from that point in out, it's just editing text files, and you can basically create your, if you want to have fancy programs to add ports and add contexts and stuff like that, then you can script them yourself, because it's really easy, because you'll just be manipulating text files, so you can just use set and stuff like that, and then just run the compiler and go ahead. So, yum list raw height, raw height. Fedora, I'm not sure what the difference is. I'm not sure what the difference is here, but let's just install yum install Fedora release raw height no arch. Oh, no arch. And then basically nano, or actually just let's just ls first. Ls etc repos d. And we have a Fedora raw height repo there. Fedora raw height repo. And then nano that. Oh, I don't have nano installed, obviously. In the minimal install, so I use vi enabled raw height developmental whatever. Yeah, so this one I where am I set to 1, and then it's quit, and then let's see what else we have. We need to disable probably the Fedora repo and Fedora updates. Fedora repo. Yeah, it's still enabled. And the updates probably as well. Enabled. So basically I'm updating to raw height. Okay, so yeah, basically yum update and it'll take raw height now. And this will take another while. Installing for dependencies, motor manager, firewall config, standard, kernel manager. Okay, let's just do that. So yeah, the nice thing about this way of managing it is just text files. That's just nice. You don't need all those tools. One to compile a policy package, the other one to install the policy package, and stuff to add ports and stuff like that. In my workflow, it's just edit the text file and then run either a script or run the two commands manually. There's basically a couple commands that you need in the SLinux user space. Load policy is what I use. The SLC, SCCLC compiler is what I use, and fix files or set files. And those are basically installed by Fedora, so you don't have to actually. But this is going to install Fedora repo created. I don't know what the hell is going on here. It's 22, so that is actually raw height, so that's fine. So you don't need all those tools, those SE module, SE manage and stuff like that. They are working on integrating the SIL infrastructure into SE module and SE manage, but I'm just that's not something I am interested in. I'll just use the bare workflow. instead much easier, at least if you know the policy language. That's the only thing that it requires, is that you know how to talk to S-Linux. That's the only thing that you need to know. Other than that, it's just really simple. And hopefully I'll be able to actually demonstrate that and basically show you that that's really the case, that it's really easier to do it that way. And hopefully someone will actually test it out, do what I do now, and then basically maybe even contribute to the policy. It's in GitHub. I can actually show you that in the meanwhile. This is your GitHub Doveride E145 repository here. And you can actually basically create send pull requests if you have something reasonable. If you're new, then the first time I will probably scrutinize your pull request very thoroughly. And if it turns out to be a good commit, then you'll earn trust, and then I'll start looking less thorough. But if your commit is not right, then eventually I'll spend less time reviewing, because I have other things to do in life as well. So yeah, just if you want to contribute, then make sure that you really know what you're doing, you really test it thoroughly. I test my stuff very thoroughly, compile every time, and that's a nice thing with SCCLC. It's very fast, so you don't have to spend ages to compile and to load. It's just very fast. So if you want to contribute, make sure you test it, make sure you test it thoroughly. If you want to create the test cases and stuff like that, so that you make sure that if you commit, if you send a pull request, that you really think it's worth my time reviewing it, and that you think that it eventually will be merged. And if you don't do that, then yeah, then eventually you'll lose my interest, and then it will be hard for you to get anything in. So anyways, but so this policy model doesn't use MCS. MCS is really, I don't see what the big fuss is all about. You can achieve with MCS what you can with the type enforcement, what you can achieve with MCS, and you can even achieve more with it. The only drawback is that it requires more policy. But on the other hand, you can create more tailored policy. So I'm not going to explain how MCS works, but you can basically compartmentalize a single program with different processes spun from them, single program with different categories, so that they can't mess, those two processes can't mess with each other. Now you can do the same with type enforcement, it only requires more rules. So on a large scale enterprise system where you have like thousands of these processes spun from a single executable file that you all want to compartmentalize, then you might think about MCS, because else your policy will get so big that it's gonna get slow. But other than that, there's no real benefit of MCS in my view. And MLS, that's just something that we don't use. We don't use confidentiality. That's not on my laptops. That's not a thing. And user-based access control, it's nice, but I don't use that either, because you can also do that with type enforcement. Oh, this is the wrong thing. It's done. So we updated to Rawhide. I suppose. Oh yeah, let's do a yumdistro sync. And then let's just install IP table services and disable cron downgrading.
weird. I'm not sure what this downgrading is all about. But yeah, let's just disable firewall D, install IP table services, enable IP table services, disable cron, and then disable some. Let's see what we need. We can disable to make it look like how I actually use it, because also I'm going to get into some scenarios that I probably haven't foreseen. Look at how slow Fedora as Linux policy targeted is. But it's also much bigger than my policy, so you can't really compare it, but still it's just so, takes so long to install. And in my, with the policy that I'm now currently demonstrating, it takes a couple seconds. Let's just first reboot. Booting into Rawhide. root ABC123. And then it's system control, disable. Oh, this keyboard is so sticky. Disable firewall D. Yum, install IP tables. Services. Actually, let's just stop system control. Stop firewall D. SSHD, because that's not supported. And then install. Yeah, install. IP table services. At least a little bit how I do it. And then disable cron. And stop cron D. And stop SSHD, but I already did that, didn't I? Okay. PS out. And this looks pretty much how it should look. Let's just ls that. Oh shit, I actually need I'm going to need ls all etc sysconfig. And we have an IP tables config. That's nice. Although, I did something stupid. Basically, Let's just sit down, reboot one more time, just to make sure. I'm going to actually need to send files, and I don't want to type stuff in, but I guess maybe it's not as bad as it seems. It's all green. Root ABC123. Let's see if everything is running the way I expected. We have oh yeah, modem manager, I'll also disable that one. System control disable modem manager. That's not supported either. And stop modem manager. Because I don't have a modem. And stuff like Bluetooth, but that's not started, so that's works. Here you have an unconfined service network manager dispatcher. I actually haven't covered that in my policy either. So I wonder what that is all about. Anyway, so let's just start. So first we need that the compiler. Oops. So let's just see if we can get that. It's in my repositories, and the SCCLC spec. This is basically what you need. Now, GitHub user content com raw GitHub. I'm going to try and type it in. Okay, try it out, see if we can type it in. Wget, oh, and I probably don't have wget installed. Vim install wget. And yeah, I also need RPM dev tools and stuff like that. So I'll just install that as well. Vim install RPM dev tools. And does it install Git? I think it does. That's a install Git. Light GNOME keyring. Can you believe that? Lib GNOME. Okay, and then just wget the URL. So wget. Oh, and I probably can't build that way. Exit Joe ABC 123. Joe is part of wheel, so you can sudo RPM query list RPM setup tree RPM dev tools setup tree. Oh yeah, RPM dev setup tree. So RPM dev setup tree. And then CD RPM build sources, yeah. Or actually specs. But let's just go to source because I'm going to have to download the sources as well. Sources. So let's just done. Specs. Wget https raw GitHub user. Override SE sales spec master SE sales spec. It saves something. Okay, so inside that spec, there is a URL here. Oh, and this sucks. Let's go to sources. I can't copy because I don't have the QMU guest agent installed, so I can't copy and paste from the host. And I don't have SSH installed, so I have to actually type that in. Wget https github.com git. Linux project sil archive and then the stupid commit 803 AF 326 8F B65. I need the full link, unfortunately, and then sil the commit again. 803 AF 326 AF E65 F4 EECE 6 E 6 6 9 6 oh 8 3 A 7 9 6 A D 5 7 C A 3 and then tart is it. Hopefully I didn't make any typos, but probably did. Tar TZ. It seems it actually did. So need to install some more shit. Sudo shell abc123 install yum install gcc live se ball static, and you only need this to build, so there's no requirements on, or no requirements on make. What else do we have? Core utils. Utils. XML2 DB latex for the docs. And if all is well, then that should just take care of it. Okay, plenty Dependencies. God damn it, that sucks. $500 max. Jesus Christ. It's gonna take a little while again, unfortunately. But yeah, you want the compiler. Else it's not gonna happen. And this should be pretty much the latest version. I haven't looked at it. I could look at it and see if there's any commits in the meanwhile. It's gonna take a little while anyways. But probably not. It's pretty stable currently. Stable enough for my taste at least. Oh, let's see, when, an hour ago. So that's nice, and here we have some more. So yeah, we actually have some new commits here, 7 days ago. So it's not the very latest version. I'll update the spec soon, so just keep an eye on the SECLC spec repository that I have here, and then I'll add a new commit. See, I'm maintaining this thing here. If you look at the commits, and you'll see that I've been maintaining this spec for a while. It's an easy spec, and it's not the perfect spec either, by the way. Because if you install, it creates a default SECLC package, which also includes documents, but it also creates a documents package with also the documents. So if you install them both, then you'll get into conflicts. Say, I'm not that interested in packaging, so I just basically package. It works for me, and I started doing other things. But if you don't install the documents package, then you'll be fine, I suppose. So yeah, setting this up takes a while. So yeah, this repository is at github.com/doveride/seclc/doveride/seclc-spec/, and then you can get the latest there. And then just get the spec, install the dependencies, the build dependencies, which are in the spec. But if you don't do that, then you'll see that when you build that it fails, and then you'll, most of the time you'll see what it needs. But if you just install the build requires, then you'll be fine, I hope. Not installing. But yeah, there's already some differences here. That network manager dispatcher, I haven't got that covered, so that should in my policy end up in the systemd daemon domain, which it should actually probably work, or if it, yeah, in theory that should probably work. Let's just see. There's always bugs, there's always stuff that turned out not expected. Alright, so let's just do it. See if it builds the package. RPM build dash PA, and then go to the spec, or point to the spec. Spec SECLC. Back, and if all is well, it
Where am I?
Feel to start. Well, you know what, Joe, RPM build, oh, in specs actually, that's why it failed. Oh, fuck.
The hell? I was hoping.
I made a fucking typo, probably. 803AF326 8F D65F4EEC2 6E6 96 083A7. Oh, there you have it. 79 796 AB. Oh, actually, stupid.
RPM build. Sorry, it's also a little bit hot here. Specs, SE, still C spec. I was rude while I shouldn't have been rude. I thought I installed Bison. It was in the list of requires. Yeah, obviously, because else. RPM would not have been able to tell me. Okay, so RPM, oh, sudo shell, RPM, UVH, and I'm gonna have to type in a bunch of shit again. Home, RPM, Joe, RPM build. RPMs x86-64 SE CLC 0.0.12 git 803 AF 22 FC 22 x 60 RPM. Hopefully I didn't make a typo, but of course I did, I always do. Get AO3 AF 33 12 version 12 x 86 64. The hell am I overlooking? Home Joe RPM build. Yeah. Okay, so now that is installed. Okay, now on to the next thingy. Let's go to the repository E145. So here you have the repository, you can actually clone it, and here you have the clone URL. Let's just type that in. Christ's sakes. Um, let's just oh yeah, let's just do it like the following: cd etc as Linux, and this created make e145, and then chown recursive joe e145. LS all set, and now we have an E145. Okay, so now we can actually as a non-root user, we can now clone that git clone https github com. Give me a break, please, to override E145 git. Override E145 git. Okay. Oh, god damn it. RM E145. cd etc as Linux, god damn it, and do it again. Fuck. Okay, cd e145. So now basically we can go into the source directory, ls, and create a script here, then of Vi, because I don't have nano Vi, and I'll call it build script, build shell. And basically, what that has is the following: bin bash, and then basically user bin sclc. And what you need is the, or what you don't really need, by the way. What I encourage is that you use the verbose. It's a very neat feature. Get listing. It's a very neat feature. And then I think it's output file. Policy. 29 and F for file context, I suppose. Context files, file context. That should be it. Gmod. Plus x build shell, and let's just see if that works. Build shell. Oh, not found. So let's just have a look at that. sclc help. Yeah, that's O. So what the hell am I? O and F. Oh yeah. Might wanna. And then probably compile some shit here. Yeah. RM policy 29. It compiled it in the root. And file context. So we need to remove that. And I'll build it again, and if all is well. Oh yeah, that policy directory is not there. See? So cd, or actually just make their policy and then build it again. Okay, so now it's all there. So basically, nano etc as Linux config, edit that. Oh, and not nano phi. Habit. Insert. Call it E145. Oh, God damn it. Sudo shell. Always takes so fucking long. E145. Alright, quit. Okay, setup force 0. Yeah, we need root anyways. Setup force 0, load policy. And now fix files. Relabel. To relabel the file system. So we loaded up the E145 policy. I need to basically apply the file labels there. Now, this policy depends on the user Joe being on the system. Because in the policy, the file contexts are actually just explicitly specified. So it actually labels, and that's all. Also home Joe proper, but that's because Joe is specified in the policy. It's in a text file. I could actually grab R Joe, and you'll see here that Joe is hard coded, but these are just text files, so you can just edit. So if you add a new user, for example, you'll just create a wrapper around user add. So you'll run user add, and then you'll basically create a small script that basically, for example, grabs for an existing user and then duplicates every file context of that user to the new name and replaces it with the new name, something like that. But it's all just text files, so it's really too easy to manipulate. It's not, you don't have to run what is it, gen home file dircom special commands to get that to work. It's just a matter of editing a text file with a either manually or with a script, run sclc the build shell script, and it'll update, and you might want to relabel in some cases. Some cases you don't need to relabel, and that's it. So let's just reboot, but we'll reboot in permissive mode just to be sure the first time. E, edit, and then just edits the boot line, and then enforcing 0, just to see, because there are issues, obviously. Control X to apply, and this boot. And of course, obviously, it's all green because it's in the permissive mode. But I will also test it in enforcer mode. Joe ABC123. And one of the first things to test is the ID of Joe. And the ID is proper. Let's just have a look at the psaus command. Now, everything is looking mighty fine. Everything is looking mighty fine. Yeah.
Pocket, DSC client, login, dbus, login D, network manager, system D. Oh, actually, that's been weird. This is a weird thingy. System D. RD is running in the systemd domain. That's weird. How did that happen? LSRZ user has been RD invalid. That's why it's fix files. Why did that not apply? Oh, Christ's sakes. Okay, let's just let it rip. I'm sorry, I need to be rude, obviously. But it seems to have a need to reset some file context, so there is actually some labeling problem. Yeah, whatever. Whatever. Whatever, whatever, whatever. Okay, sudo shell abc123 fix files relabel again. Let's see if RD is labeled properly. LSRZ user has been RD. Yeah, now it's labeled properly. I don't know why. It's actually, let's just do it the old fashioned way. Because there's still, as you can see, it's still running with the unconfined U stuff, and that's why actually it didn't, it turned invalid, because that unconfined underscore U identity no longer exists. So we really need to force a full relabel, and fix file relabel should have done that, but obviously it didn't for some reason. And that's why the stuff turned mislabeled. So that explains why it didn't work. So don't use fix files relabel, just use restore con capital R verbose force, and that'll reset the identity field as well. Takes longer because obviously now it resets everything that had a wrong identity as well. But it already gave me a pretty good impression about how it's just probably just going to work now in enforcing mode. So I'll just shut down in permissive mode and then start up in enforcing mode and then shut down in enforcing mode to show you that it might work. And at that point, you have yourself a guest system where you can test your policy on. If you want to contribute, then basically you can just basically use that straight from the etc SE Linux E145. You can just edit stuff there, run the build script. I'll just demo that, and then just update your Git or create a new branch or whatever, and then basically test it straight away. Make sure that it builds and works the way you expect it to work, and then basically push it to your GitHub repository. Create a pull request,
And then you know, so you need to actually do it in an interactive way, actually test it, actually have a guest, a virtual machine where you can actually verify that it works. And eventually you see that this is much easier to maintain, but there is one prerequisite. You need to know the policy language. So shut down, reboot. Now it's in permissive mode, so rebooting will work regardless. But it's booting in enforcing mode. So, could be that things turn red now. You have, yeah, see there is some stuff. We have a debug message, so we have some problems. We're in enforcing mode, get enforced. But we did face already a problem. Journal, control, B, dbus, or grab I dbus, grab I bus. This keyboard is so sticky, or is so.
Dbus socket failed, no such file or directory. Denied. Vart adds inode, is there an inode there? No.
It could be yeah, here's the problem. I thought I dealt with that. Let's sudo shell. Maybe lsoc var, these links, that's the problem, is that the I fixed this on my system. The hell? There are some thingies, if you look, this is a weird issue that I had with it's with how stuff is specified in temp files and in unit files. They specify var run, and for some reason that causes stuff to get mislabeled. But I thought I'd fix that by labeling the symlink properly. Obviously, that's not happening. LSLZ. In no cases. Okay. Let's just fix this the ugly way. this is one of those things that happened because I I changed the foreign type to run. I thought I fixed this. This is nasty. Anyways, I'll just grab R var run var run user lib temp files d. So there's always stuff that turns out to be not working. Now we can ignore the SE Linux one, the lib SE Linux one. So it's v user lib temp files d. And this, you need to fix this in a persistent way. You need to move these files to etc temp files d, because else they will be overwritten with a update. Insert and change this to run. This is some weird behavior that I can't really explain. Init scripts. Annoying as shit. They wanted to move var run to run, and they now still they fuck up by referring to var run. They think, okay, we'll just dump a link there and everything will be fine, but they don't think about, or as, and it's also as a Linux fault, obviously. Well, I'll be goddamned. Okay, and I'll forget that SE trans stuff. That is not defined in policy anyway, so next grab recurse var lib of var run user lib systemd system and see you have the debug socket here. So v user lib systemd system debug socket. That's why that socket can't be created. So stupid, so weird. And I thought that by labeling and these plemmets also use lib systemd plemmet start socket. Start service. But this might actually work. It seems to be only a problem with early boot stuff. It's just for shits and giggles. CD var. CD store. Gone. R. D. F. Run. Lock. Okay. Shut down, reboot now again. See if that works in force mode. And it actually shuts down fine. Let's see if it reboot if it boots now in a forcing mode. And this is not the only tweak that you have to make. There's another tweak. And I'll show you that as well. You see, ABC 123, ID, get enforce, enforcing, PS out, and now DBus is running. Alright, so if you do LSLC, run user, then you'll see that the run user thousand directory Joe's runtime user directory is labeled tempfsd. That's because systemd labels, or actually systemd mounts tempfs on the thousand directory, and that therefore the thousand directory turns up with the type of the file system, and that's wrong. And my policy doesn't allow systemd to actually write in there. So there's nothing in there. And that's because systemd was not allowed to create anything in there. If I do an out search mavcts1722. Then you'll see some, what the fuck is that? Ah, sudo needs sysadmin. I didn't see that on my policy. But sudo is going completely nuts. Oh, actually, set files needs sysadmin. Maybe there was, I'm not sure why that is. Login needs sysadmin. I thought I gave her, and sudo needs sys, everything needs sysadmin for some reason. There might actually be a bug. Yeah. Okay. Now this is also, let's just first deal with the outer log is so flooded with shit that I can't find it, but systemd was denied access to create stuff and run user 1000. So restore con fixes that, but then the socket is not there because systemd wasn't able to create it there. So yeah, that's a bug, and until systemd fixes that, I'm not going to allow it the policy, but restore con fixes it from restores it from tempfs to run a session, and that is the policy works for that. For example, pulls audio creates a directory in there, and that is allowed. but systemd not yet, because I haven't actually dealt with that yet. So there's some shit going on there. Now, anyways, let's just yum update. Another thing, you need to be careful with RPM, because it is unconfined and it should in theory work most of the time, but I already had it fail miserably because for some reason LD config, I'll be damned, for some reason LD config ended up with default T-type, which is default type, so I think it might have been created. I'm not sure why, how it got the way it got, but, and I don't understand why this is either. Fry etc yum repos d fedora raw hi repo. Seems to be up to date, then maybe we just hit a bug, but I don't see this on my other system. But the fact that everything needs sysadmin, that doesn't look too good, that doesn't look right at all. So let's just shut down, reboot now. It was still in enforcer mode, by the way. Get enforce. So yeah, stuff works, but there's just seems to be some weird stuff going on there. Reboot. It reboots cleanly, or I did see a warning or something. Not to go so fast that I can't actually. But from the look of it, it all works. You have to keep in mind that everything is basically confined, pretty much confined, except session T. Itself, and then there's the system daemon domain, which isn't actually used. Joe ABC123 date 1730 sudo shell ABC123 restore from rvf run user. I'll search M ABC user ABC as the name is TS 1730, and yeah, it's still the same. Sudo one sysadmin, and does sudo have sysadmin in Fedora policy? Let's have a look. Rawhide contrib. Oh, this is not. Well, just. It might actually be that it needs that, but the weird thing is, on my system, I don't see it. So, oh, and actually, sudo is not fucking part of the trip. Is it admin? I think admin sudo interface. Yeah, so this is a bug somewhere. Good thing I didn't hit that. I think it might be a bug in DLIPC or something like that, I suppose. But that's not allowed. So yeah, that's the problem with Rawhide. You'll get to deal with all kinds of stupid bugs. Well, actually, yeah, you get to deal with all kinds of stupid bugs, and you get to figure out whether something you allow is something that you need to allow, or something that's just due to a bug. So that sucks major. But here, yeah, it's just pretty obvious because everything all of a sudden needs sysadmin. So, yeah. But anyways, it works, and it seems to work. And if you now look at lsalt run, everything is labeled properly now. So yeah, there's a couple of gotchas there. But now the policy is actually pretty neat. Everything is pretty confined there. If you look at with SE search and stuff like that, and you see that there's it's pretty tight. And you have sudo, so that stuff is also confined in the user space. So if you install, for example, ERC, so let's just install ERC, install ERC, and this stuff just should also just work. But with RPM, be careful. It's always nice to. If, for example, if you do a yum update, that you just only update a few packages at a time, so that if it fails, that you can fix it easily. Because if you have like hundreds of packages that are updated, and all of a sudden something goes wrong, then you'll need to fix them all. And I've been there, done that. So okay, so exit and out ERC. And but this doesn't PSXE. See, and ERC is confined here. So your ERC is also confined, and MERT is confined, and GPT is confined, although probably a lot of bugs in that policy as well. And there's a bunch of other stuff that are confined in the user space. But again, I demonstrated most of the issues that you might face, and to be honest, I don't think you need to actually have to edit those service files, service units, and those temp files, a pass from Varun to run. Maybe I needed to restore con another time or something like that, but on my laptop, bare metal, I hit this problem, and then I changed in the policy to label the link files in var, the var run link file, the var lock link file with the lock type and the run type, and that fixed it for me. But it didn't fix it in this case. But anyways, those are just bugs. They should just run the slash run instead of slash var or slash run, because those are paths that are no longer used. So they should just edit it. So if you want to fix that file bugs reports, tell them to change those paths to slash run and instead of slash var slash run. And that's basically all. You can actually just see the etc as in Linux, so E145, and basically just edit stuff. So cd policy sources, and for example source, well, I'll be at source policy, I think. Well, I'll be goddamned, source, cd source. For example, vi contrib erc, for example. And this should actually be IRC, and it is IRC, isn't it? Or yeah. So for example, if you want to allow a rule, some stupid rule, allow is ERC subject some type HTTPD port HTTP, and obviously that policy isn't proper. TCP socket, you need to actually put that in an optional block. Name bind, just to show you how easy it is. Name bind, 1, 2, 3 parentheses. Your parentheses is something that you probably need to get used to. And then just basically build shell, and it will update your policy, and then just sudo load policy ABC123. That might be a bug. That might be a bug. I'll search. Look at all these. This is disgusting. It might actually be related to this issue here. Because it should just work. But anyways, if you now do yum install edit tools console, then you'll see that that rule is in there. And it's that easy. And then basically all you have to do is git push to push it to your repository. So it's very easy to maintain. Let me search. A source session RCT, and then target is at port HTTP, and there you have it. The rule is in place. So that's how easy it is, and you can do that with port cons, with anything, file contacts. Basically, you just, if you have some nice shell scripting skills, they can basically just do the same as what SEManage does and more with just a shell script, because the text files are all there. So you can just boom, create a nice script that just sets, does a set or some else aux shit to replace stuff or add stuff or query stuff. And just runs the SCCLC compiler and load policy, and bang, you're ready. Your policy, it's applied. So no need for SEManage, no need for SEModule, nothing. And that's basically it. So yeah, it's not perfect, but it's pretty good, I think. But it's just basically all only in this instance. If you install a G, then things might break down or might not. Might it actually work to a large extent, or it might not. So shut down. Reboot now or halt now. Want to see if I can. If it's fast enough. Warning, Dracut warning, and I don't know what kind of fucking warning. But it reboots, or it shuts down, but there's a warning there. So yeah, there's a bug there as well, I suppose. And to troubleshoot that is a huge, huge pain in the ass, because there's no AFC denials. It's just a matter of guessing. Anyways, that's it.